Welcome to EPG Padasala. Today on Indian culture, under the principles and methods of archaeology, I will talk on antiquarian law. Myself, Dr. D. Dayalan, ex-director, Archaeological Survey of India. This is actually the antiquarian law is basically a law which is pertaining to the safeguard of the archaeological monuments. For every country, there is a strong need of a legal framework to safeguard our cultural heritages. Otherwise, it's very difficult to safeguard our cultural heritages. For the development of antiquarian laws, it starts right from the beginning, particularly during the time of the colonial period. The antiquarian laws has been started, and it has been developed day to day according to the necessity of the monuments and the requirements of the safety guard of the monuments. The antiquarian laws are found both state as well as central levels, because both the central as well as state enacted the acts. In addition to these, there are many landmark judgments which has also been pronounced by the government of by the Honorable Supreme Court as well as the courts on different levels for the safety and security of our cultural heritages. Some of the important antiquarian laws in India are the Indian Treasure Trove Act 1878, and then followed by Indian Ancient Monument Preservation Act 1904, Ancient Monument and Archaeological Sites and Remains Act 1958, Indian Ancient and Art Treasure Trove Act 1972, Ancient Monument and Archaeological Sites and Remains Amendments and Validation Act 2010. These are all some of the important landmark antiquarian acts in India. As you know that India is a very rich cultural heritage, and cultural heritage is the identity of every nation. And everyone has the responsibility to see that it should be preserved for the posterity. And actually, we have very rich cultural heritage, not only cultural heritage, even the natural heritages. And for safeguarding these things, various acts as well as rules has been framed time to time by the government as well as the court for safeguarding our cultural heritages as well as natural heritages. Actually, our cultural heritages has taken very important appreciation or awareness during the colonial period. Particularly in the 18th century, there is a big movement for the protection of our ancient heritages. And in 1784, there is a big initiative taken by Sir William Jones. He has started Asiatic Society of India. This is the first one in Calcutta. Actually, it is to look after the ancient heritages and also to see how best it can be preserved. So I think this is the first act or first initiation for the safeguarding our cultural heritages. And after that, the first antiquarian legislation in India was the Bengal Regulation Act 1810. This is the first antiquarian legislation in India. Followed by that, Madras Regulation 7 of 1817 is again one of the landmark legislation to look after the monuments during the region. Then after that, there is the Indian Museum Act was passed in 1814. And then this is one pertaining to the museum activities or museum antiquities, other things. This was the first initiation, how the legislation has been involved by the public as well as the government to the risk of the monuments. However, these initiations are very limited, and only in the next century, we can see a lot of developments in the antiquity acts. William Jones, you can see here, he is the one who is responsible for the starting of the Asiatic Society, and he is the one who has taken the initiative, followed by many others like Alexander Cunningham, Burgess, and there are many other people they are involved for making the antiquarian law more forcible, more effective. In the Act 20 of 1863 was enacted to empower the government to prevent injury to and preserve buildings remarkable for their antiquity as well as historical and archaeological value. This is one of the basic law which has been fundamental for many laws to come in future. And Indian Treasure Trove Act was the first enacted in 1878. This act give more force or more effective to the government to protect and preserve our treasures of archaeological value found accidentally in various excavations, and also lawful disposal of that. Suppose sometimes when anybody digs any place, and they used to get the antiquities. So that has been not brought to the notice of the public government, and it will be goes in a different fashion. So this act gives some sort of a bounding for the people, those who are found any antiquities in their area, that should be brought to the notice of the government. And also the government, if they want, they can even purchase for the museum to be kept in the museums. In 1886, the government issued direction forbidding any person to take excavation without prior consent of the archaeological survey. So this is the one basic act where regulating or restricting the excavations in the name of for digging or looting of the ancient sites. And followed by that, the Ancient Monuments and Preservation Act 1904 has been enacted. This act give more power to the government to preserve the ancient monument for the exercise of control over the traffic of antiquities. Particularly, the antiquities has been stolen and has been sold out, and it goes to foreign countries. To control over that, this antiquities is more effective to control the traffic of the antiquities, and also exercise over the excavation in certain areas. Particularly, some people, they dig randomly in order to get the antiquities or the treasures, and then they sell it to different places, or even they melt it for different purposes. So in order to prevent this sort of unauthorized excavations in the archaeological sites, this act gives an empower that the control should be there for regulating or preventing this sort of unauthorized excavations in certain areas. And also the protection and acquisition of ancient monuments and of objects of archaeological, historical and artistic interest. This is again very important. This is the first initiation to bring the archaeological monuments and antiquities directly under the control of the government. Here, the archaeological monuments or the historical sites where the government wanted, it can be protected and for the posterity, and also for the safeguard and safety of the monuments can be looked after by the government. This act provides an authority over the monuments, particularly those which are not under the control of the individual or private ownership. Certain monuments in the early period, but is before 1904, it is all maintained by the private ownership, and they use these buildings, the heritage buildings, in their own fashion. But this act gives more power to the government to enact over them, to see that it should not be randomly reused, and also it cannot be modified as per their own whims and fancy. So this is the one act which gives more emphasis to retain the monuments as per its original character. After independence, there are many antiquarian laws has come up, and particularly the Antiquities Export Control Act 1947, and followed by its rule, is provide a regulation over the export of antiquities. This is the one basic thing which is controlling over the antiquities. It has been further amended in 1972. In Article 49 of the Constitution of India mentions about the protection of monuments and place and objects of national importance. Actually, this is the Constitution itself pronounced that the protection is very important. Protection of monuments is very important, and it should be safeguarded as national important. Even it's a fundamental duty of the every citizen of India. The Constitution of India pronounced that to value and preserve the rich cultural heritage of composite culture. This is the fundamental duty of every Indian citizens. And also the 7th schedule of the Constitution of India allocated different duties of the state and central government, in which also the archaeological monuments figures. It was as well as the state central government, as well as state government, and also some of them it is a combined responsibility of both state and central. The fulfill after this Constitution of India, to fulfill the provisions of the Constitution, the above act was this actually the ancient as archaeological sites and remains Declaration of National Important Act 1951 has been enacted, and this act actually what are the monuments which has been preserved, and the Ancient Monument Preservation Act 1904 has been redeclared as national important monuments and sites under this act. Actually this is a actually it is just after 1904 this is another landmark act, this is 1951. Some of the monuments which are under the protection of the state government are also been included as a central protected monument under the State Recognition Act 1956. And another landmark act is the Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Act, and followed by rule. This is 1958 and 1959. This is one which is a basic act even now. The government of India is following, and this is one of the very important act for the protection of the monuments, excavation of the antiquities, and also the cultural value of the protection of the cultural value of our heritages is concerned, is very important act. And the Ancient Monument Acts is actually enacted in 1958 mainly to preserve our archaeological wealth. And as I told earlier, the ancient monument and archaeological sites remains rule. That is, rules is actually giving explanation to the act. It is followed in 1959. Both has came into force in 15th October 1959. Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Act 1958, followed by the rule 1959, are empowered the central government to declare any ancient monument or archaeological sites and remains as national importance under this above act. So there, any monument where the government of India feels or central government feels, or any monuments or archaeological sites, that can be declared as a national important monument, and it can be put under the protection of the central government. Under section 5 of the act contain acquisition of rights of protection monuments. Suppose the particular monument or the particular sites is under the control or under the ownership of a private owner, the government can have the right to acquire that particular property from the private owner, and also even accept a kind of gift or some sort of a donation from the owner of the particular property. Second thing is to exercise power of the owner of the monument or site refuse to fail to enter in the agreement. Suppose the owner of the particular property, the ancient monument or sites, is refused to undergo an agreement or refused to hand over to the government of India, the government can make enforce some sort of they can exercise some powers to make him to come to an agreement for in the interest of our cultural heritage. And then some of the function, the previously it has owned or it has been vested with the district administrative officer or the collectors, but now these powers are now vested with the Archaeological Survey of India, because the Archaeological Survey of India is mainly responsible for the preservation of the monuments and also taking care of the antiquities in India. And actually, this Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Act 1958 have many precise definition of the terms which has been often used in archaeological rules as well as archaeological sense. One is ancient monument, antiquities, archaeological sites and remains, maintenance, protected area, protected monuments, and prohibited area, and others. So these are all the very important terms which is often used in the archaeological act as well as archaeological studies. Ancient monument means any structure erected or monument or any tumulus or any place of interment or any cave or rock sculpture, inscription or monolithic which is of historical, archaeological or artistic interest and which has been in exercise for not less than 100 years. And it includes the remains of the ancient monument, the sites of the ancient monument, adjoining area of the monuments or site, or the mean of access to the ancient monuments. Not only the monument, even the access to the monument, adjoining area of the monument, that also part and parcel of the ancient monuments. So this is the basic definition of the ancient monuments. So any ancient monument, it should be of historical, archaeological, artistic interest, and also it should be not be less than 100 years. And these are some of the monuments. As you know, India is a very, very varieties of archaeological monuments, right from the rock paintings, even rock prehistoric rock shell paintings, rock shelter, Harappan remains, monolithic temples, caves, stupas, monasteries, churches, mosques, and then the temples of different varieties, palaces, forts, like that. So India is a very rich variety of archaeological monuments, right from the prehistoric time till the late period. So we can see the varieties of archaeological monuments in India. The protection of these things is very important, as it's being a kind of a cultural boost to our people, and also economically it is viable. And archaeological sites and remains means any area which contain or is reasonably believed to contain the ruins or relics of historical or archaeological importance which have been in existence for not less than 100 years. And again, it includes the land adjoining the area and also mean of access to the area. So this is the fundamental definition of the archaeological sites and remains in the archaeological act as concerned. Apart from these are the varieties of archaeological sites we have. We have the Harappan settlements, we have the prehistoric settlements, and also the various megalithic burials. Like that, there are different varieties of monuments, even the archaeological sites also, we have the varieties of archaeological sites we have in India, right from the Harappan time till the late medieval period. Ancient monuments, as I told, it's basically responsible for enacting many provisions for the central government. One is the maintenance of certain protected monuments, protection of places of worship from misuse, pollution, and other misuse of that monument, and right to access to the protected monuments. This is very, actually some of the monuments previously it is not the public were not allowed, but after when it is declared as an archaeological monument or the monument of national important, the public shall have the right to access to any protected monument. And restriction of the enjoyment of the property right in the protected area. Suppose protected area, the protected monument is owned by the private person. Through agreement, central government can take over that building. And he has been, powers enjoyed by the owners can be restricted in that particular area. And these are some of the, the acquisition right, preservation of the monuments, which is as per the agreement. These are also some of the important provisions in this act. This act also give a guideline about the excavations to be carried out in the protected area and unprotected area. In this, the power of central government to control the movement of antiquities also been given in, earmarked in this act, and also purchase of antiquity by the central government. Suppose whenever the central government wants, they can even purchase the antiquities. That also it has given. Even those who are destroying, removing, injuring, altering, defacing, or misusing the protected monument or the protected archaeological sites, the penalties It has also been given in this act. And also some of the sculptures or antiquities which has been moved unauthorizedly, for that also, what are the penalties to be given for them? That also been given in this act. And next important act is the Antiquities and Art Treasure Act 1972. This is basically to give more power to the government to control the movements of the antiquities. Actually, this act has an effective control over the movable cultural properties, because the Ancient Monument Act 1958 is basically on the immovable properties, whereas this Ancient Antiquities and Art Treasure Act 1972 is basically movable cultural properties consisting of antiquities and art treasures. It regulates the export trade in antiquities and art treasure, and also provide prevention of smuggling or illegal trafficking of the antiquities. And sometimes even the government have the empower to compulsory acquisition of antiquities and art treasure from the public. And this is a very important act, particularly the antiquities as concerned. This act was supplemented by the Antiquities and Art Treasure Rules 1973. This act gives some of the fundamental definitions of some of the terms like antiquities, art treasure, export, license officer, registering officer, other things. These are basically used often in this act. The antiquities, as per the act is concerned, antiquity means any coin, sculpture, manuscript, epigraph, or any work of art craftsman, any article, object, or things detached from the building or cave, any article, object, or things illustrative of science, art, craft, literature, religion, customs, morals, or politics in bygone ages, any article or objects or things of historical interest, or any article, objects, or things declared by the central government to be an antiquity as per the act, which is not less than 100 years. These are some of the antiquities we have in India. Particularly, we have the stone sculptures, bronzes, seals, ceilings, coins, and then copper plates, terracotta objects. Like that, we have varieties of antiquities in India, right from the early time to till now. And regarding manuscripts, the act says any manuscripts, records, or other document which is of scientific, historical, literary, or aesthetic value, and which has been in existence for not less than 75 years, it has been considered as antiquities. These are some of the manuscripts, particularly palm leaf manuscripts, and then some of the paper manuscripts. Like that, we have many manuscripts which is more than 75 years old, and manuscripts are available in India. And actually, this act is putting in exercise for the last 3 decades. There are some shortfall has been observed, and now this has been being amended to see that it should be more effective in order to control the smuggling of the antiquities, and also to see that the safety and the security of the antiquities found in India, because we know India is very rich archaeological antiquities like bronzes, sculptures, coins, and then various jewelries, all the things we have found in the Indian. So this is very attractive to the foreigners, and many antiquities has been exported, or it has been illegally exported to foreign countries. To control these things, this has been now being amended to see that it can be very very effective to look after these sort of illegal activities. And then recently, Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Amendment and Validation Act 2010 was been enacted. This is basically to see the activities in the prohibited and regulated areas. It is actually an amendment in the original act, in the Ancient Monument Archaeological Sites and Remains Act 1958. This act actually give more emphasis on the prohibited and regulated areas, because what are the some of the illegal activities, or some of the activities which is not in conformity with the archaeological monuments is happening in the prohibited and regulated area. This act is mainly enacted to see these activities can be regulated. And again, there is a monument, National Monument Authority has been created in this act. Actually, this monument, the National Indian monuments can be looked after by the National Monument Authority. Actually, the monument, National Monument Authority's main duty is to recommend the central government for grading and classifying the protected monument, oversee the work of the competent authority, and also suggest some of the important suggestion for the implementation of this act. As I told earlier, the section 20A and 20B has been declared a prohibited and regulated area around the monument or archaeological sites. That is about 100 meters considered as a prohibited area from the protected monument, and further 200 meters as the regulated area. And you can see this is how the regulated area and protected area have been marked around the monuments. Certain monuments you can see here, particularly in Agra, where you can see how the center is the monument, and then first circle is the regulated area, the prohibited area, second circle is the regulated area, like that. So every monument has been now studied, and then this prohibited and regulated area has been earmarked so that all the activities, particularly the construction activities within the prohibited and regulated area, has been monitored so that it should not be any way absurd activities should happen in the close vicinities of the monument. And here we can see how Taj Mahal, it is the historical setting of the Taj Mahal, where you can see the Yamuna River is flowing. On one side is the Taj Mahal, the other side is the Mehtab Bagh, little further the Agra Fort. This is the historical setting of the monuments. For any changes in this historical setting will give you a distorted picture about the history of the particular area. So it is necessary to safeguard the environment, and that's why this Validation Act has come into force. And you can see how badly the environment has been affected. So these are some of the reasons how the act is very important to safeguard the environment of the monument. And then in addition to the central government, there are many state government, they also enacted very different acts. Various state governments, they also enacted as per the constitutional provision, they also enacted different acts. There is Orissa Ancient Monument Preservation Act 1956, Assam Ancient Monuments and Records Act 1959, Andhra Pradesh Ancient and Archaeological Historical Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Act 1960, Maharashtra Ancient Monuments, Archaeological Sites and Remains Act 1960, Rajasthan Monuments, Archaeological Sites and Remains Act 1961, Karnataka Ancient and Historical Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains 1961, Karnataka Treasure Trove Act 1962. And then Mysore Ancient Archaeological Monuments and Historical Monuments, Archaeological Sites and Remains Act 1961, Madhya Pradesh Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Act 1964, Punjab Ancient and Historical Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Act 1964, Madras Ancient and Historical Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Act 1966, Bihar Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains and Art Treasure Act 1976, Himachal Pradesh Ancient and Historical Monuments and Archaeological Sites 1976, Goa, Daman and Diu Ancient Monument Archaeological Sites and Remains Act 1978, Arunachal Pradesh Ancient Monument Archaeological Sites and Remains Preservation Act 1990, Hampi World Heritage Area Management Authority Act 2002, Delhi Ancient and Historical Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains 2004. These are all some of the important state government acts. Apart from that, there are many other acts that have been enacted by various state governments. Apart from that, there are many landmark court orders has been given by the Honorable Supreme Court, as well as the High Courts, and also various courts for the safety and security of the monuments. I can just give some of the landmark example, particularly in the Taj Mahal, which is one of the very important monuments and also the symbol of our Indian culture, where the Supreme Court is very concerned about the safeguard of the environment of the Taj Mahal and enacted very different acts. In 1993, they ordered the closure of the industries around Taj Mahal, which are polluting the air around the Taj Mahal vicinities. And in 1994, directed the development of the green belt around the Taj Mahal. And again, 96, staying unauthorized construction within 200 meters from Taj Mahal. And again, 10 May 1996, directing with regards to the control of the pollution in the licensed brick kilns within 20 kilometer radius distance of Taj Mahal and other monuments in Taj Tripusium zone. And 17 March 1997, a direction not to allow any vehicle, generator or sound equipment within 500 meter of Taj Mahal. These are some of the landmark acts or the orders pronounced by the government, the Supreme Court. And in 7 December 1998, no commercial activity shall be allowed within the premises of the Agra Fort or any other protected monument Agra in the Taj Tripusium zone. And 5 December 2005, to set up a committee to submit a report in respect of rehabilitation of the area which was disturbed by the reason of the construction made in pursuance of the Taj Heritage Corridor project. Like that, there are many act has been provision has been made by the Supreme Court. Then they have pronounced many orders for the safety and security of the monuments, not only Taj Mahal, even the monuments throughout India. Supreme Court issued orders pertaining to Fatehpur Sikri, controlling or restricting the mining activities. And also similar way, even the Taj Ajanta caves, where there are a lot of important paintings are there, the government has stopped moving of any pollution vehicles in that area. The ancient monuments, you know, these ancient monuments and sites are the testimony of our civilization, because this is the one of the symbol of our nation, and also it is a proud of being the monument belong to our nation. It is the need of the protection, and hence a comprehensive law should be there to look after or to protect the monuments in an effective way. Apart from that, already I told, as per the Constitution, it is the fundamental duty of every citizen of India to preserve our heritage for the posterity. That's why there should be a very strong regulation is required, and also the public's also to be proactive to see that the monument should be preserved for the posterity. Thank you very much.